Please be seated, sir. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I request you to please take your seats following the COVID protocols. Shall we start, sir? A saying goes that there are three C's in the life, that is choice, chance and change. So we here at Himalayan Phytopathological Society took a chance and we chose to bring a positive change through the symposium on plant health management beyond 2020. Ladies and gentlemen, present in the hall and all the dignitaries who have joined us online Pan India, we welcome you with warm wishes for your good health in the inaugural session of Symposium on Plant Health Management Beyond 2020, organized by Department of Plant Pathology in association with Himalayan Phytopathological Society. It is with great honor and pride that I introduce you to the chief guest of today's function, who is not only an alumnus of this university, but a scientist par excellence and member ASRB. Please give a big hand to Dr. P.K. Chakravarti, member ASRB. We welcome you, sir. The function shall be presided over by the Honorable Vice Chancellor of this university. We welcome all the delegates, all the researchers, students, scientists who have joined us online. Sir, we would like to tell you that this is for the first time that we have roped in an agriculture startup called Volcus Technological Solutions from Bangalore. They will be showcasing that how smart agriculture can change the lives of the farmers. So taking the program ahead, I request the Honorable Vice Chancellor and all the dignitaries to please light the Saraswati lamp for the Saraswati Vandana.
Lamp is not visible.
Thank you very much, sir.
Kindly
be seated on the dais, sir. I request all the dignitaries to please take their seats. Thank you very much. To honor the graceful presence of dignitaries, what is better than to gift a memento that is laced with divine interventions? So therefore, Himalayan Pathological Society came up with an innovative idea of making Kashtkuni temple replicas. I would like to tell you that Kashtkuni is an indigenous construction technique prevalent in the isolated hills of northern India, especially Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. This technique was devised keeping seismic activity, topography and cultural ethos of the land. So I request Professor and Head and the President of the Society, Dr. Gautam, to please honor the Honorable Vice Chancellor with shawl, cap and this memento as a token of our respect, sir.
आप इधर को आपने
Thank you very much, sir. I would again request Professor and Head Dr. Gautam to present the Kashtkuni temple replica to the chief guest of the function, Dr. P.K. Chakrabarty. This replica shall be handed over to the chief guest by the special envoy to Delhi. I request the Honorable Vice Chancellor to please dedicate this award to our Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. P.K. Chakrabarty, sir.
Thank
you very much, sir. I request the Secretary of the Society, Dr. Narendra Kumar Bharatji, to please honor the Director of Extension Education, Dr. Ravindra Sharma, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, I again request Dr. Bharat to please present a bouquet to the Dean College of Horticulture, Dr. Anju Dhiman. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Taking the program further, I request Head of the Department and President of the Society, Dr. H.R. Gautam, to formally welcome the chief guest delegates of the function, sir.
Good morning to all. First of all, I welcome our most respected chief guest of the function, Dr. P.K. Chakrabarty ji, member Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, Honorable Vice Chancellor of the University, Dr. Ravindra Kaushal ji, Director of Extension Education, Dr. Ravindra Sharma ji, Dean College of Horticulture, Madam Dhiman, Statutory Officers of the University, Head of the Departments, and all those who are connected to this program. It gives me great pleasure to extend to you all a very warm welcome who are present and connected virtually to the inaugural ceremony of the symposium on plant health management beyond 2020 on a topic which is of international importance, and this theme will certainly guide the global agriculture in the 21st century. On these occasions, I feel privileged to extend my warm welcome to the chief guest of today's function, Dr. P.K. Chakravarti, member, Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, New Delhi, for gracing the today's function. Sir, it is a glorious moment for all of us associated with this pioneer department with magnificent history of accomplishments of more than 56 years, and that this department is now organizing this national symposium under the aegis of this Himalayan Phytopathological Society. And the crown glory is that an alumni of this department is our chief guest on the occasion. We all eagerly waiting to listen to you, sir, to guide us on this arduous path of challenges. We took this challenge to organize this national symposium under the stewardship of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, who always has been the guiding force to provide technology umbrella to the farmers right from the start of the COVID crisis. I, on behalf of the organizing committee, welcome you to the inaugural ceremony of this national symposium and thank you for acceding to our request to preside over the proceedings of this session. Sir, we drive all this energy from your continuous guiding spirit and encouragement. I also welcome Dean College of Horticulture, Madam Diwan, and Director Extension Education, Dr. Vinder Sharmaji, for their valuable help and guidance in organizing this program. As most of our distinguished guests are out of the periphery of this seminar hall, I welcome all the statutory officers of the university, professors, heads of both the colleges to the inaugural ceremony of this national symposium. I also welcome all those farmers who are connected with this program, and all our efforts in this symposium are directed for churning out useful recommendations for application in the field. It is my profound privilege to welcome all the distinguished scientists who have won accolades in their respective fields for accepting our request to give the lead presentation on the topics of national importance in this symposium. Your contribution will certainly be like a beating heart to the proceedings of this symposium. I also welcome all the scientists who have made valuable in the form of their research findings to give strength to the deliberations being contemplated during these two days. Supply and support of inputs in the form of seeds, fertilizers, pesticides and technology are critical and of paramount importance for the sustainable and accelerated growth of agriculture. We are successful in roping in some important ventures, and I welcome all of them to be part of this important event. I want to also welcome the print and electronic media, and particularly the social media platforms like YouTube, Facebook, for the outreach of this program among all in different parts of the country. As President of Himalayan Phytopathological Society, I wish to share the magnificent journey of this society. The scientists and students of this department formed the Himalayan Phytopathological Society during 2017 with a vision to create a forum for discussion, deliberations, communication for furthering the discipline of plant pathology to develop sustainable disease management practices for the crops grown in the Himalayan region and other areas. The society is engaged in organizing various activities like workshops, brainstorming sessions, guest lectures, field visits, farmer site interaction, publication of e-magazine, technology notes to further the science and technology output out of plant pathology. Since its inception, the society has organized important workshops and symposia either individually or in collaboration with other important national and international societies. The present National Symposium is organized to celebrate the Golden Jubilee of Statehood of Himachal Pradesh and 56 years of creation of our Department of Plant Pathology, which is a way forward in our such endeavors. As the success of the symposium largely depends upon the participants and the lead speakers, so I thank all of them. While deciding to organize a national symposium of its own, we also took the challenge to choose a topic of smart agriculture, which will guide our agriculture in this century. It is an opportune time to draw a roadmap for the development of agriculture. Agriculture sector needs infusion of new technologies which will enable the primary sector to move to the next level of farm productivity and profitability. Innovation and new technologies in science open new avenues across the different fields. While the first revolution in agriculture was possible due to mechanization, the second green revolution came with genetic modification. Precision agriculture, which consists of precision application of inputs when and where these are needed, has become the third wave of modern agriculture revolution. There is a need to adapt next generation technologies to achieve higher productivity of crops using less energy, fertilizers and pesticides, while lowering level of greenhouse gases and coping with climate change. India needs green revolution, and for that we have to go for a technology revolution. Smart agriculture has all the technological inputs which can steer us from the problem of low productivity and labor constraints. There is a need to adopt precision agriculture that makes the use of information technology to achieve precision management with the use of new technologies. Armory of new technologies like cloud computing, Internet of Things, big data, blockchain, robotics and artificial intelligence have taken the management of agriculture operations to much higher level of technology. Artificial intelligence is the science of instilling intelligence in machines so that they are capable of doing tasks that are traditionally required by the human mind. The term artificial intelligence is commonly used when a machine mimics cognitive functions such as planning, learning, reasoning, problem solving, knowledge, representation, perception, motion, manipulation, social intelligence, and creativity. AI combines automation, robotics, and computer vision. Drones with artificial enabled vision processing capabilities are being used to assess the real situation or condition of the crop on the ground. Autonomous drones and the data they provide can help in crop monitoring, soil assessment, plant emergence and population, fertility, crop protection, crop insurance, reporting in real time, irrigation and drainage planning, and harvest planning. Autonomous swarms combine the technology of swarm robotics with a blockchain-based backend. Swarm robotics involves multiple copies of the same robot working independently in parallel to achieve a goal too large for any robot to accomplish. By leveraging the benefits of both swarm robotics and blockchain, pesticides and fertilizers can be applied more efficiently. IoT is an agriculture context referred to the use of sensors and other devices to turn every element and action involved in farming into data. These can be the things that can be embedded with technologies, software or sensors, which further helps in connecting or the exchange of data with other devices or systems via the internet or vice versa. Such technologies are bound to bring precision in the delivery of various inputs required in the crop production and application of crop management practices, and this will help us to achieve increased yields, lower costs and reduced environmental impact. It is estimated that with the infusion of new technologies like the IoT, there is potential to increase agriculture productivity by 70% by 2050. Thus, there is a need to introduce new technologies to overhaul the traditional resource-intensive food system. The transformation of agriculture production, rural economy, and natural resource management requires the support of these technological innovations. There is a need to develop infrastructure in our agriculture institutions to have scientific understanding to such technologies for their use, so that farmers are trained for the use of such technologies and equipments in the field. There is need for strong support backup of the service providers, companies and the agriculture institution to put these technologies on the fast forward mode for adoption among the farmers. Everything else can wait, but not agriculture. These words are attributed to our first Prime Minister Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who mentioned these words after independence in the context of Bengal famine of 1942-43, when there was an acute food scarcity prevailing in the country in 1947. In this hour of COVID crisis, we the scientists and all other stakeholders in agriculture have great responsibilities to steer our farmers to success in the field of in these difficult times. We in the Department of Plant Pathology have always been taking such challenges to be with the farmers with our technologies to cushion the impact of diseases to a minimum. Our every sincere effort will help us in the mission of our Prime Minister Modi ji to double the income of the farmer of this country by 2020. In the end, I will again welcome our chief guest, Dr. Chakravarti, and the our honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Kaushal ji. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I would like to tell the people who have joined us here and online that this year Himalayan Phytopathological Society has constituted 3 awards in different categories. First, Bill Munjal PhD Best Thesis Award. Second is Young Scientist Award. And third is Innovative Farmer Award. To announce this award, I request Organizing Secretary Dr. Narendra Bharat to please come and announce these awards, please.
With the permission of Honorable Vice Chancellor, I would like to announce the awards of the society. These awards have been initiated, especially the Young Scientist Award, PhD Best Thesis Award, and Innovative Farmer Award this year only, and another award, Lifetime Achievement Award. So, first, I would like to announce the Young Scientist Award. And the Young Scientist Award, it goes to Dr. Pramod Prasad. Dr. Pramod Prasad, Scientist Plant Pathology, Regional Station, ICR Shimla, Flowerdale. So, Dr. Pramod, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, Dr. Pramod Prasad, Scientist Plant Pathology, Regional Station, ICR, IIW, Shimla, after completing his PhD from G.V. Pant University, Pantnagar in 2011, he joined as scientist in Regional Station of ICR, Indian Institute of Wheat and Barley Research, Shimla, in September 2011, and now working as scientist senior scale since 2015. He is working on population biology, host pathogen interaction, and genetics of rust resistance in wheat and barley rusts. He has worked on genome sequencing of Pakshinia species, wheat and barley rust surveillance, evaluation of wheat and barley material against Pakshinia species and gene postulation, development of rust resistant genetic stocks, population dynamic and host pathogen interaction studies. He is handling 3 such projects from DVD and ICR. He has published 53 research papers, 1 book, 14 book chapters, and many popular articles. He has submitted 8 sequences to NCBI and presented paper in 10 international and national symposium. Himalayan Phytopathological Society feels honored to bestow Young Scientist Award on him for his research efforts in the field of wheat dust. And I would like to tell you that this award carries cash amount of rupees 11,000 also. So I would... Now the next award is Dr. R.L. Munjal PhD Thesis Award. And this year the award goes to Dr. Ashish Janroji Barghane. Dr. Barghane, are you there? Yeah. So Dr. Ashish Barghane, Assistant Professor, Faculty of Life Sciences, Mandsaur University, Mandsaur, Madhya Pradesh. He has done his PhD from SHU, Agriculture Technology Science University, Allahabad in 2018. With 88.6% PhD thesis title was Molecular Detection and Characterization of Citrus Distilla Virus and Candidatus Librobacter Asiaticus related with the citrus decline in India. Under the guidance of Dr. Dilip Kumar Ghosh, Principal Scientist, now Director of ICR Central Citrus Research Institute, Nagpur. In his PhD work, he standardized RT-PCR protocol for the detection of citrus distilla virus and Candidatus Librobacter Asiaticus, developed RT-PCR based protocol used for the implementation of citrus budwood certification program, developed loop mediated based isothermal amplification assay for the rapid, sensitive and robust detection of citrus distilla virus, the most devastating pathogen of citrus worldwide. This is the first developed kit in India and second in the world. He deposited 68 DNA gene sequences in NCBI gene bank. The data generated in the thesis used for the management of citrus distilla virus and Candidatus Librobacter Asiaticus in the surveyed hilly states. He has published his work in a reputed journal like Journal of Biological Methods, Indian Phytopathology and Methods in Molecular Biology. Himalayan Phytopathological Society feels honored to bestow Dr. R.L. Munjal Best PhD Thesis Award on him for his valuable work on citrus during his PhD thesis. This award also carries cash amount of rupees 11,000. So congratulations, Dr. Barghane. So now the third award is for the farmers. That is Innovative Farmer Award, and this year this award goes to Shri Parmanand, resident of village Chamo Kasoli. He is a successful mushroom entrepreneur. He is regularly cultivating button. I would like to ask Dr. Arti to collect on his behalf. So he is regularly cultivating button western mushrooms and till now has taken button mushroom crop from 12,000 bags, earning a net profit of 10 to 12 lakhs from this venture in last 2 years. During lockdown, he could not sell his produce in sabzi mandi because the prices were very low at 30 to 50 rupees per kg. Then he, due to his innovative idea of exploring village markets, as potential avenue for good returns as during lockdown period village didn't have much access to the such perishable commodity, and he got better prices, that is rupees 70 to 80 per kg, and he could earn a net profit of rupees 2.5 lakh during COVID period. So he even used B and C grade mushroom to prepare pickle and sold it and earned additional income. He tried oyster mushroom cultivation in 50 bags and was not getting good price in Dharampur and Solan market. Then he contacted big hotels in surrounding areas and placed a few bags of oyster mushroom there, which became a source of attraction to the even tourists who started demanding oyster mushroom dishes. With this innovation, he could sell his produce at premium prices of rupees 300 per kg. His success story was even published in ICAR Handbook on Innovative Agriculture Solutions during COVID-19. He has also received Progressive Farmer Award during 36th Foundation Day of our university on 1st December 2020. So, Himalayan Phytopathology Society feels honored to bestow on him the Innovative Farmer Award for his work on mushroom farming. And this award again carries rupees 11,000 cash. Now, as some other farmers also applied for this award, and we have conferred some commendation award to them. So I would like to mention their names. Sri Rajesh Thakur, village Haribagh near Sarikanda, P.O. Mahok, Tehsil Karsok, District Mandi. So he has planted high density apple on M9 rootstock and in 1 hectare with modern technologies. Farmer Mr. Rohit Kaushik from village Kyatur, District Solan, HP, he also got Prakriti Sansadhan Bandhar from Department of Agriculture. He is performing, he has developed a model for natural farming. Another farmer, Sri Satish Kumar Gill from Nadaun, District Hamirpur, who is cultivating shiitake mushrooms, and Mr. Tejaswi Dogra from village Marahok, Tehsil Chopal, who is even advocate, but he has using all artificial intelligence and latest technology in his orchard and earning income. And another farmer, Srimati Sunita Kumari from Sundanagar District Mandi, she is also cultivating vegetables in her farm and earning additional income. So the Himalayan Phytopathology Society feels honored to bestow on all of them commendation award for innovative farming in their respective fields. Thank you. Now, I'd like to announce the Lifetime Achievement Award. And this year, the society has announced this award to Dr. Beer Pal Singh, who retired as director of ICR Central Protective Research Institute, Shimla, in 2014. So Dr. B.P. Singh.
Oh, he is here, John.
Dr. B.P. Singh. So Dr. B.P. Beer Pal Singh. He retired as director of CPRI Shimla in 2014. He was born on July 1st, 1953 in a farmer family in Bulandshahr, Uttar Pradesh. He graduated from Aligarh Muslim University and obtained MSc and PhD from the same university in botany with distinction. He joined CPRI Shimla in 1977 and rose to the position of joint director of the institute in 2000 and took over as director of the same institute in 2010. He is an international authority on late blight of potato and published over 200 research articles in national and international journals. He discovered the phenomenon of sexuality in Phytophthora infestans in India for the first time and contributed in development of more than a dozen potato varieties, developed late blight forecasting models and decision support systems. He identified botanicals and bioagents for eco-friendly management of potato late blight, identified unique germplasms, developed an aeroponic system of potato seed production, etc. So he has been awarded Hari Om Asarvatast Award, late LC Sika Award, and other awards. And now Himalayan Phytopathological Society feels honored to bestow Lifetime Achievement Award on him in recognition of his excellent research efforts in developing effective technologies for the management of potato diseases, with far-reaching economical well-being of farmers in the state as well as other parts of the country. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I would like to tell the house that this year Himalayan Phytopathological Society has two major publications. One is Souvenir and Book of Abstract, which has 90 abstracts and 26 lead lectures. And one is a book on technology strides in plant health management, which has been authored by Dr. Narendra Bharat and Dr. H.R. Gautam. I request the Honorable Vice Chancellor to please release these Book of Abstract and the Book on Technology Strides in Plant Health Management. Sir, we would like to tell that it has 18 lectures from different ICR institutes across the country, and 6 chapters have been contributed by the scientists of the department. This book has focused on smart agriculture, and it will decide the course of action for the next 50 years, sir. This is a book, Technology Strides in Plant Health Management.
Sorry, please. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Second is the Souvenir and the Book of Abstracts, which has 90 abstracts and 26 lead lectures from scientists of the various institutes, sir. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I request the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Dr. Y.S. Parmar University of Horticulture and Forestry, Dr. Parvinder Kaushal, sir, to please come on the dais for his words of wisdom.
Good morning to everybody present in this hall and online at different places in the country. It gives me an immense pleasure to be here this morning as this university is organizing a national symposium on plant health management in 2020. The occasion becomes important as 2021 is a golden jubilee year of statehood of Himachal Pradesh. I feel privileged to welcome one of our alumni, Dr. P.K. Chakravarti, member of ASRB, New Delhi, as a chief guest of the inaugural function. Sir, your excellent achievements as a scientist and as an administrator as the glory of this university, which is our strength. Plant health management is always important to get optimum yield from the crops. And this needs continuous efforts to work on such technologies which are affordable and environment friendly. Seminars and symposia are the platforms to discuss applicability and suitability of the technologies. I appreciate the efforts of the Department of Plant Pathology to organize such symposia periodically at the main campus of this university. I'm happy that Himalayan Phytopathological Society has shouldered this responsibility of organizing this national symposium by working in tandem with this department with a goal to help the farming community. As we are fighting the menace of COVID pandemic, the department still took a challenge to organize this national symposium, which is really praiseworthy. The department has a magnificent history, as has already been told, of such accomplishments for more than 56 years, since 1965, when an MSc program was initiated. The department, with strong faculty, has made a niche in farming community of the state. Scientific acumen and technology precision of the faculty helped the farming community of the state to combat with serious diseases in fruits, vegetables, and ornamental crops, which otherwise would have badly affected the economy of the city state. Over the years, the scientists of this department were able to successfully control important diseases like scab, prematurely fall, white root rot, the canker disease of apple, rhizome rot of ginger, buckeye rot of tomato, phytoplasma of peach, powdery mildew and anthracnose of mango, bacterial canker of pomegranate, diseases of ornamental crops, etc., etc. Even during last year, the department successfully helped the farmers in managing the apple scab disease when it again appeared in some pockets of the state. The department is also pioneer in developing the mushroom production technology in the country during the 70s, which has now become a major entrepreneur for the youth of the state and the country as a whole. Today, the major concern in Indian agriculture is the production of safe and quality food, as has already been discussed. And now, emphasis is given on eco-friendly methods of disease management. And the department is vigilant on emerging disease problems of horticulture and forestry crops. Work on diagnostic technologies of pathogenic fungi, bacteria, viruses, etc. is also undertaken besides developing virus film planting material in important food crops like cattle. A very appropriate theme of the symposium, that is, the plant health management beyond 2020, has been chosen, which is very pertinent, keeping in view of the present era of climate change, changed patterns of land and water, varieties of production of safe food. Presently, there is a need to for more focus on the use of new green technologies, especially for the crop production, especially in plant health management. Having two revolutions, the third one, we are focusing for the new technologies, the use of new nanotechnology, information technology, drones, etc., is really useful. The scientists should provide ready to use technologies to the farmers, and I am confident that the present symposium will certainly enrich our knowledge with the convergence of experts, as I have been told, from more than 80 leading ICR institutes, agricultural universities, different parts of the country, other states, and our faculty in this university. I hope that the participants will make best use of this symposium to exchange their ideas and develop new vistas for their future endeavors in this important field of plant health management. I also appreciate the idea of initiating the awards with society
like Young Scientist Award, Innovative Farmers Award, Dr. Munjal PhD Thesis Award, and Life Achievement Award. And I would like to congratulate all those who are the recipient of these awards today, Young Scientist Dr. Pramod and his institute. Dr. Munjal's PhD thesis to Dr. Varghane. Nowadays, we need the virologists, as we have seen in the COVID-19. The future, today we have the problem in the human beings, maybe in tomorrow, in the plant kingdom, we may face such problems. I also would like to congratulate our innovative farmers, especially Mr. Pramod Paramanand from Himachal, the Kasauli, who has really shown his entrepreneurship during the hard times. Others who are also innovative, Rajesh Thakur, Mr. Kaushik, Satish Gill, Mr. Togra, and Sunita Kumari, those who have been doing work in their own fields of agriculture production. Lifetime award for the life of a scientist is always a big achievement and satisfaction for him. And for the work, for the life he has dedicated to the society and to the country. Dr. V. Pal, the former director, CPAL Shimla, I would like to congratulate you, sir, for this award. I applaud the efforts the professor and head department of plant pathology and his entire team for their best efforts in organizing this symposium. I also, especially during this COVID-19, like to congratulate all of you, those who have been associated, our deans, directors, and other faculty and students. I would like to say, this is a difficult time we are passing in the country. And the most important task for the day, for the days to come, is to protect ourselves. When we talk of plant pathology, so the pathology, what we are seeing, the virus, is around us. So please reduce the social mixing. Have effective face mask use and follow the COVID appropriate management practices. With these words, I would like to convey my good wishes for the success of the symposium and would like to thank especially Dr. Chakravarti to be here with us and all the speakers, those who are participating for this 2 days symposium. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your inspiring words. Now is the time, ladies and gentlemen, that I would like to call Dr. P.K. Chakravarti, the chief guest of this function, for his words of wisdom. I request the dignitaries seated on the dais to please be seated on the sofa so that they can hear Dr. Chakravarti with ease.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, so nice of you. Am I audible, madam?
Sir, you are audible, sir.
Good morning, everybody. It is always nostalgic for me to come to Himachal Pradesh, and once I took charge as the ADG Plant Protection way back in 2013, and before that, nearly for 30 years, long years, since I left the institute after doing my MSc, PhD, I was based in Cotton Research Institute. Then after I came to headquarters, I left no opportunity to visit the university, the alma mater, which has made me the person what I am today. Honorable Vice Chancellor of University of Horticulture and Forestry, I'll say this is a great university, not because that I have done from there my MSc and PhD, but it really has a big potential in the national endeavor. And Honorable Vice Chancellor is also the president of today's national symposium. He's a very impressive personality. We also had him as an expert in our ASRB board. And I found him a very pragmatic person. And my first meeting, although when I was student from 1979 to 1985, end of 85, beginning of 86, I saw him. But then my first meeting with him happened, I hope Professor or Vice Chancellor Prabhinder Kaushalji, he remembered that we met first time at the Birsa Agricultural University when where the AICRP on soybean was being held, and I found him so bubbling and so with the new ideas, new thoughts which he gave to the ICR scientists who assembled there, and that's why the meeting was held there, because at his BS. I would also like to address here the Director of Extension, Dean College of Horticulture, Dean College of Forestry, Statutory Officers, then Organizing Secretary Dr. N.K. Bharat, Dr. Harendra Raj, Professor and Head Plant Pathology, Galaxy of Scientists, my worthy seniors, many of them I see here, Dr. Indra Mohan is there, definitely Dr. Bipal Singh, who had been the director of Central Potato Research Institute. I had been interacting with him at many times, many occasions, very effective director he was. My other known people, now there are 58 people, most of them I know. Dr. Ritu is there, Dr. Subhash Bhardwaj, Dr. Sanjeev Sharma, Dr. Panyal, Dr. Rakesh Gupta, Dr. Bimal, Dr. So most of these people, I should not, because of the confidentiality, Dr. Jameel Akhtar is there, my very good colleague and friend in Delhi, a very effective person in NDPGR and plant quarantine related activities. And I proudly say that most of these professors, Dr. Inder Mohan and all, I have invited in ASRB because I know their talents, and I have had them on one of the occasions. Dr. Vimal Chauhan is there, so we called him because, and many, all of you, I believe, I should not tell all these things in open public, because of your talent, because the talent these scientists have, many of them could not come for their own reasons, but I have a special respect for all of you, Galaxy of Scientists, then young pathologists, research fellows, students, farmers, award winners, today's award winners. I remember name of Dr. Arul Munjal. He was my guru for mycology. The mycology which he taught me 40 years before Dr. Indra Mohan Sharma might be knowing. I'm still remembering that book on Elasmopolis with him, Dr. A.D. Sharma. Unfortunately, he died at a very young age of, in 40s, mysteriously he died. But they were the ones, Dr. K.R. Sham was my guru, my MSc PhD guide, and Dr. R.K. Agarwala was the head of department when I left the institute. In fact, I thank at the outset the Honorable Vice Chancellor to have invited me on the occasion of this third National Symposium on Plant Health Management beyond 2020. I can keep on talking about this institute because it has carved my future. It has made me more than what I could have gained had I studied in some other places or place. In fact, I feel honored that I did my MSc and PhD in plant pathology. In 85-86, I came out when we were gearing ourselves for managing plant health management during 20th century. And what a nostalgic time it was. At that time, there was you will be, many of the youngsters will be surprised that science of molecular pathology had not taken its root. It had taken its root. The structure of DNA had just been deciphered in 70s and 80s. The first transgenic was made in 1986, and the recombinant DNA technology. The year I left the institute, so we were not heard, while at the time BT cotton was the first transgenic technology which was being made at the time, and we at my time I did not hear, but came to abreast with all these advanced technologies only after I left the institute, and then I started in ICML doing all this work. The foundation of modern plant pathology is laid in India in 1905, which is now 115 years old, and is equally important today, and plant health management is paramount to ensuring food and nutritional security even today. Let me tell you, today India is the highest producer of food grains to the extent of about 305 million metric tons of food grains and 318 to 20 million metric tons of horticultural crop. Unfortunately, we are losing nearly 55 to 60 million tons of food grains because of the pathogens. So this is such an important, that biosecurity is such an important in ensuring food safety and nutrition security of the country. And that's why realizing the potential of this and the need for International Year of Plant Health, which UNO had declared in 2020, the year, and this year is still continuing as the International Year of Plant Health. So it is at a very right time that the organizers have thought to have this national symposium, and I'm glad that by the turn of the century, we were gearing for our century, which was 20th century, and we were relying only for the management by chemical means or by bidding for conventional the resistance, which was there, which was the latest technology, which was time-ticking process, but still we did our best. This institute, I also would like to tell that I take pride in telling that this has so much talent. I see Dr. Subhas Bhagwaj in front. I boast to tell that he topped the ARS exam, and in one batch, in 1985 batch, there were only 5 seats in ARS in plant pathology, and all 5 were from University of Horticulture and Forestry. You know, it was such a great history of this institute. Besides that, Dr. Tilak Raj Sharma, whom we selected as a DDG, he is also a product of the university, and he is one of the renowned plant pathologists of the country. Dr. K.K. Sharma, Dr. J. Kumar, Dr. Bhagwaj, Dr. Kiran, Dr. Yash, Dr. Ved Sharma, Dr. Josna, Dr. Subhash Chandra. The list is endless, because those who have really come out of the Himachal Pradesh and gave ICR a way forward in endeavoring the plant pathology towards 2020 year. I am glad that by the turn of the century, organizers have started strategizing plant health management beyond 2020. Now that the new biotic stresses have evolved, chronic diseases have reversed, and a number of invasive pathogens and pests have gained domestication within the state. Now I am talking about country. There are every year, as an ADG for 6 years, I have seen every 6 years miraculously, and I was very surprisingly, I saw every 6 years, each year I saw a new pathogen or a new invasive pest which gained ground and gained home within the country, and many of them within the state of Himachal Pradesh. So, besides science of plant pathology, has advanced at a lot and has made detection and diagnosis more precise. New breeding tools and molecular approaches like marker-assisted breeding and map-based cloning of R genes, transgenic development and genome editing as a means of resistant management are being employed. These are being actively employed, and these are the technology which will take and usher plant pathology in the new era of 21st century beyond 2020. Thus, conventional breeding for disease resistance is no more a lone technology with chemical management of diseases which we used to have and which we used to manage our diseases. Agriculture contributes to 13% of total GDP of Himachal Pradesh, which is equivalent to 1,82,000 crores of rupees of the state today. And agriculture thus contributes to rupees 23,660 crores, out of which nearly rupees 6,000 crores are lost due to disease every year. Now the members of very eminent members of Himalayan Phytopathological Society must get aroused at these figures. These are the huge figures. If the amount of losses we can protect today, India is already the world's highest producer after China, but we will the world's the highest producer of the country. We can feed additional 50 crore people by protecting the losses which are happening at the moment. So in the state can save a lot of its exchequer which is lost. Himachal Pradesh is a food fruit bowl of the country, especially apple, and besides vegetable share is higher than the fruits now. Apple scab, which was initially, which had decimated apple in Himachal Pradesh during 1982-83 when we were doing our the PhD. At that time, farmers used to be given nearly 1 rupees or 2 rupees or 5 rupees to dump and to bury nearly 1 quintal of the affected apple with apple scab. But the same disease after 38 years, after nearly 4 decades have emerged in the country. And this year, at some places there are 25 to 30% losses in apples that happen. So there is a great responsibility lies on the shoulder that why this disease, which had been stalled, and it was taken as a success story of Himachal, the Honorable Vice Chancellor has said that apple scab was one of the diseases, like many other diseases, buckeye rot and other vegetable diseases which were there, stalk rot of cauliflower. These are the diseases which were there. And now this is going to incur a loss of nearly 1,150 crores to the state, which I calculated myself because I had a program project as ADG for estimating the losses due to various diseases. So apple scab alone is going to have last year a loss of 1,150 crores. Besides various other chronic and endemic diseases of palm and stone fruits, vegetables, new pathotypes of late blight and yellow rust, which Dr. Subhash Bhardwaj has been ably handling, and he has a greater challenge now. New pathotypes are building with greater force, and flax smut of rice is another main crop, cereal crop, which is grown in the Himachal Pradesh and Kashmir. So that is coming up. Besides a number of diseases of medicinal and aromatic plants, which our Honorable Vice Chancellor himself published a paper in 2016. I took time to go through some of these papers and what is being done in Himachal Pradesh. Clearly, Himachal has been doing a lot, but then the mounting pressure due to biotic stresses are not coming to any rescue. It is going on increasing. New diseases and patterns are coming up. Stock rot of cauliflower, for which the Sabdoon Valley is the only valley in the country for seed production, was being done. And so you have to find out some causes. Although we had, my thesis was on third rot of cauliflower, and that was one of the things. But at that time, we were not knowing there was a lot of gap between the theory and practice of whatever you do today in plant pathology is not going to be implemented. It cannot be implemented. They remain theoretical in nature. And then our student today who study plant pathology, which is one of the most important subjects in agriculture, should realize that whatever they are doing, they should see that practically and by policy they are applicable to the field. What about the causes ultimately and the remedies they are finding, well, they are implementable. Although it may sound a little outdated, cultural control and strategic control even today has its own importance and important role in plant health management. Today we all talk about molecular bases and molecular bases and genome editing and all those kind of things. No doubt they are the very potential and technologies, but in the quest of it, we forget the basic strategies which we underestimate them. This I would not have realized unless I visited Australia, Australian apple orchards recently, where I found four important pests which are managed just by strategically by cultural methods of control. They have made all the, because the major economy of Himachal Pradesh is because of moose and that too because of apple. And I took it a point to visit their apple and cherry orchards to see how they're managing, because all these diseases which you have, apple scab and all those apple woolly aphid, I hope we do not have now here, but there were some reports, I don't know whether they are false report or true, that they have all those things. And come clean and go clean is their strategy. Before every orchard, they have written a big banner or a board written with come clean and go clean. So they would love to welcome you in their orchard, but they have surrounded all their orchard with the fencing, leaving one opening to go out and now go out. And when a person go in and goes out, he has to wait it through disinfectant impregnated mat, so that any inocula or inoculum which you are carrying from this field or which you are taking into his field, you are getting them eradicated by wading through that small place of about 1 meter area through which you enter. So we should also do that, and you will find that miraculously they have protected their orchards from apple woolly aphid. They have seen, some of them have, but many of them they do not have at all, because we are practicing this come clean and go clean strategy, which is one of the major important cultural strategy. Then training apple plant in two dimensional areas, so that geography, so that the trees are exposed to sunlight from east and west. I have seen at least 10 different orchards where they have trained, instead of our kind of training of apple, which is done in 360 degrees, apple are growing. I counted as a control whether they had a 360 cultivation also. Number of roots were more in two-dimensional training, and where they have made sun rises from east to west, it remains exposed to sunlight, and with this you will be surprised to know 98 to 99% apple scab management they have done without use of a single spray or application of fungicide they have done. And that was the one learning I took from their places. Sorry, I just got out from COVID, and many of my colleagues who are from Delhi, they might have either seen that and how devastating this pathogen, the virus which is there, which is lurking all around Delhi now. And I have not seen a pandemic. We have been hearing about the pandemic in plants and also in animals for a long time, but this time I have experienced myself what this even now P.R. Sharma and all, we are living in the same campus, all of us. Sorry, I am telling this because I do not have much courage the day Honorable Vice Chancellor invited me, but then I thought for my own university, whatever may be, so I am now calling and delivering my talk from my home. I could not go to office because I do not have that weakness which now comes there, that is a very difficult thing. And I am glad that you in Himachal Pradesh are protected. It's such a nice state to be. And I wish, I pray God, that you all have the mask which on all the time. And so keep safe. May God bless you all. Similarly, planting apple sapling inside the corner guard, there could be planting every apple plants inside a corner guard through which they are protecting it through any splash of spores of corner rod spores with the protecting the main corner region, and then also having practicing judicious use of pesticides. These are the cultural methods which are similarly, they are also pre-planting every row of apple orchard with an ornamental rose plant. And I thought that was because of some ornamental reasons, but when I asked them, they said, no, it is not for ornamental reasons, but it was an indicator plant. And the powdery mildew comes first about 10 days before on those indicator plants, which are still important, which we have forgotten in our education in plant pathology probably. And then they start planting or spraying their pesticide on their apple plant, because 10 days before they know what pesticide, whether they have to or they do not have to. That involves judicious use of pesticide. Molecular diagnostics have become today. Now I will tell something regarding the molecular diagnostics. Every university, every lab in the country, the molecular diagnostics have become a fancy for all labs. Beyond 2020, these precise molecular diagnostic kits, I would like, in fact, should be routinely. I also have a patent kit ready to use the African base of Zanzibar's malvaceous cotton, but hardly some use is there in case of plant quarantine, because I have given that to plant quarantine, so that because African nations are still a quarantine person in the country, but seldom it is used. We are not used to, but we want to make molecular diagnostic kits. So you all must develop them. You must use them, because very precise. Today COVID is also related with molecular techniques only. You know, none of the other serological technologies are also being realized as important as RT-PCR. So you must use them routinely beyond 2020 before planting for prevalence of the pathogen in the soil or in the air. The prevalence can also be ascertained in the source post-harvest. After the post-harvest, one of the biggest importance of molecular diagnostic is to derive a link between asexual phase and sexual phase. Many of you know, all of us, because we have been taught by Dr. R.L. Munjal, who have been taught this mycology by Dr. R.L. Munjal, we will not forget that most of these ascospores, these asexual spores, they have their resting phase as sexual phase, sometimes totally morphologically different from their asexual phase. Same thing when they rest during the resting period, hibernation or estivation period, they remain there in the soil in the form of two spores or in the, but they are distinct from the asexual phase. But then molecular diagnostic can differentiate, can identify both of them and link both of them. So why don't you go before or after the harvest? You use these molecular diagnostic kits to see whether the same pattern exists in another form, in the sexual phase, in the soil, so that your the interventions for crop management should start from before the beginning of the new season. Pure 2020 sensor-based electronic noses based on specific volatile organic compounds which are released by specific post-pattern interaction. You know, every bacteria and plant, every fungus and plant, when they interact, late blight and potato, when it interact, Dr. Sanjeev Sharma must be there, I know. And because all these it's not a new technology, Dr. Sanjeev, you know. And yeah. there are I have seen that Australia, New Zealand, they employ this electronic nozzle, which is based on a sensor-based detection of this volatile organic compound released from a specific host parasite interaction, you can know which crop is infected with which pathogen. And there are a number of such kind of software which have been developed, and I could not collect all the literature. At least in that one site, 100 of those softwares I can send to some of you, maybe to Dr. Harinder or to anybody of you, that there are established electronic nozzles which you must start working. Otherwise, you are not going to make any dent or difference between 20th century plant pathology, which we did, and 21st century, where we have to bring and take plant pathology for plant health management. Optical and infrared reflectance technology for diagnosis of infected plant. It has become very common. The moment you go out of the country, out of the border of our country or periphery of the country, you will see these technologies being widely employed. But we always seldom talk about. So I would wish that there should be a disruptive technology on plant pathology or policies which should be taught. Subjects should be created where policies, and we have nowhere related to ISPM. You know, we have plant management and IPPC are there, which are the International Plant Protection Convention. So we have to comply with. So many of our students will not be knowing today what is IPPC, whereas all your exports, all your imports have to be guided by those. The ISPM are there. There are 21 ISPM which are there. So you have to teach them all except for, I think, Delhi in MPPGR and all. These things have not been taught effectively. Biosecurity is not being taught. Agroterrorism has become a new subject. And this is, if I am not wanting to myself to be quoted here, but I do not hesitate to see that this COVID which has come, that may also be a result of such kind of agroterrorism, or which we can say agroterrorism. Few years before, you have seen there was wheat blast, which I feel there was no reason for it to come directly suddenly from the border in Bangladesh. From Libya, a consignment came and wheat blast came onto the crop in Bangladesh area, and which we, for the first time in the history of probably the plant quarantine and NBPDR issue, Government of India took a great step in burning all the crops in the border area, and a wheat crop holiday was created in the eastern zone, because that zone hardly required nearly 8 million tons, and we produce huge 110 million tons of wheat. I know the time is running out, but I will be failing in my duty if I don't take this opportunity to arouse some of our youngsters who should initiate their work in that area. I fear with the use of smart formulation. Today, if you talk about growing a biocontrol agent in a flask or in a petri dish or in a flask and using it spores for biological control, people may laugh at us at some time, because now bioformulations have come, smart formulations have come. So the genes have been, the genome of these biocontrol agents have been sequenced completely, and in a genome, in a trichoderma, there are about 30,000 genes. Hardly 4 or 5 genes are required for antagonistic action. So you need to create a bioformulation where those 5 genes are only expressed, whereas the rest of the genes are kept at a stage, at a housekeeping stage where it is required for its growth. But 5 to 6 genes should be expressed in such a way in the culture filtrate that a cell-free culture filtrate can be used. And today, I am very glad to say that Central Institute of Subtropical Horticulture, you must be knowing the Panama will, the tropical race for, they have been able, only India in the world, there is 1 billion hectare of area is grown under banana. And many other countries like COVID vaccine, they are also looking after India for this treatment, where the scientists have found Trichoderma ricin, and bachelor's thesis, and they have grown that culture trait, and they have expressed the gene product, which is certain bacteriomycin, certain other things which are in patent form, which they are going to patent. That's why I'm not diverting them. And what they have done is they have immunized or hardened the banana saplings with the culture filtrate containing those expressed antagonistic gene product, and 4,000 of those versus 4,000 of untreated banana saplings were grown. The untreated ones, they were all suffering from disease in a sick plot, and a banana is a disease. And the remaining 4,000, so that is the, they are totally protected. That is what is bioformulation we are looking forward. We do not, although you can go ahead, do your find the most effective antagonist as a biocontrol agent, but then try to see the antagonistic principle which is there, and use the smart formulation. Avoid repeated use of same mode of action of pesticide. Because practice the pesticide use, without pesticide, nothing is possible. It is indispensable, arsenal, today, however we say, we want to have an organic cultivation. No, it's not at all possible in India or anywhere in the world. The world is hugging India by asking for organic production, because you will not only suffer in management of disease, but I am open to say that your production will also be reduced to at least 10 to 20 times lower than what is the threshold required, the production ability. So avoid repeated use of same mode of action pesticide, and prevent development of resistance. India is the country where thiamethyl is being used for 40 years, whereas European Union says it has now, it has come out of IPR issues, so they are against banning it. They are for banning it, but India is still able to manage that pesticide and no resistance. So you have to use the different group of pesticide. Don't use the same pesticide which are available in the different name of the chemical name is same. Today, how many of you are knowing that hardly 15% of the crop in India are covered by registered use of pesticide? This 85% use of pesticides in the country is going off-label. Today, it is a blessing in disguise that India is not exporting much of our agricultural produce. But tomorrow, we have to do that, because India is going to be the highest producer of all the food grains and crops. But the moment we ship them out, there will be non-tariff barriers, there will be trade barriers, because they are not covered with the registered use of pesticide. Even though farmers, they are helpless. We scientists, we have to tell them, we have to go for label expansion. So whatever pesticide, I was also not knowing when I did my NSCPhD. Some pesticide which was for controlling the new disease, and then CBI has put an embargo on them. They said that you cannot do unless a label claim is obtained, or even if the pesticide is important or fungicide is able to manage the disease, unless it is registered and label claim is taken on the crop, because there are reasons for it. There are MRL have to be fixed for the same fungicide, but when used on different crops, they are different. Tomato you use directly, you can eat. So terbinafine, MRL will be different, but the same terbinafine when it is used on wheat for management of the same disease, it will have a different MRL, because it has to go through several processes before you eat that. Traditional breeding is a long-drawn method for improvement of crop. Future technology should emphasize on identification of resistance. I will take another 5 minutes. Long-drawn method and identification of resistance team-based markers for disease product marker-assisted selection and breeding can be practiced for improvement of resistance. For broad-spectrum resistance, gene pyramiding should be done using marker-assisted breeding. In case, at least in North India, and also I know in Himachal Pradesh, you will be knowing the basmati rice is being fortified by They are all the XA13 gene, XA5, XA13, XA3 gene, many other genes which are there to build in marker-resistant PD. And similarly, pyroglaria, oryzae, the blast-causing fungus, which is also there in Himachal Pradesh. There are PIE genes, PICA genes, which have been restored, and then T.R. Sharma has done that. The first cloning of the gene, and now all our rice are being fortified by those genes. So marker-resistant breeding and marker-resistant selection you should also do, because conventional breeding in horticulture crop is more difficult. So once you identify a marker, it will be very easy for marker-resistant breeding. RNAi, I am not talking because it is a 2 decades old technology. Nevertheless, it is a very strong in potential and functional in genomic, is important in functional genomic. I am very fortunate that for 6 years I have been working in the US, and I worked on RNA interference based down regulation of some of the pathogen gene, including rice bacterial variant gene. So I am fortunate that although I did not have any formal education on molecular technology, but then I passed as a postdoc in the US, and I did 2 postdoctoral research in the United States, and then I became molecular plant pathologist. So I know the strength of this technology, but then it is 2 years old. The better technology which has come in 2012 is a genome editing technology, CRISPR-Cas9 based genome editing, which Dr. Harinder must have been teaching as a molecular plant pathology subject, and this is a very important. Recently, in 2020, in the Science, there was a paper which shows the number of target genes that reduces susceptibility of plant to pathogen. Earlier, we were knowing that we were searching only for resistant gene. Now, the scientists have started working and searching for susceptibility causing genes, because those are the targets for genome editing and silencing, so that once you silence them. Recently, in the paper, there were 56 such genes which induces susceptibility of crops to diseases have been found. That included 12 rice genes, 3 wheat genes, 2 grape genes, 1 maize gene, 2 oilseed grape genes, 1 soybean gene, 4 tomato gene, 1 watermelon gene, 26 in all. All of these genes, when they found them by genome editing, they could silence them and in turn create resistance against 26 different pathogens in all different crops. So this is the latest work which has come in Science, which was reported by an American. And this is a very important, I can give you all the paper and the review. This is a paper which you must, and also you should also teach. Now the student, I have to say, this is a matter of society, but I am telling that in the curricula, you should teach them to study a latest plant pathology paper which has come. Let one student take that and discuss it thoroughly among the group once in a week. So every paper, that way the student of today will be abreast with the latest. One of the very important research reported in Nature Biotechnology again in 2019 is the rice tall effector. Tall effector, you know, I worked on tall, and now Dr. Kalyan Mandal is working. It is called ABR or PTF gene family or HULK gene family members. Many of you know that the pathogen has these genes through which it interacts with the host. Now, one of the genes is in the rice sweet gene, which induced its expression once the tall gene of Xanthomonas oryzae binds to the promoter region of the sweet gene or sugar causing gene. This sugar gene or sweet gene, it transfers sugars from cytosol to apoplast. Apoplast means outer cell wall, and where it comes and it attracts the pathogen. So once it has been silenced using genome editing technology, they have been able to develop IR4 plants and rice resistant to bacterial life. Besides, there are a number of advanced researches are happening, like nanotechnology, microformulation, biostimulants, chemo, TF field technology for weed management. All of these can be employed for farmers in the field. However, there is no guidelines. You should know, because I have told that there is a big gap between the theory and practice of the plant pathology. Nanotechnology, everybody knows nanotechnology, nano pesticides are far more effective than the conventional form of the same pesticide. But nowhere in the world, many institutes in ICR, many universities are working on this, but there is no guidelines for nanotechnology in the world because of the penetrability problem. Nano, because they are greater penetrable and therefore safety. Nano formulation and biostimulants are the new things which have come, like biopesticides, and new regulations have come just now in 2023. Any of you are using and developing a bioformulation, you need to go by the guidelines which have been released by this Gazette of India. And fortunately, this responsibility was given to me by Honorable Director General, and I have made the guidelines. And those guidelines have been approved by Government of India, and it has come in the form of gazette notification. So you have to develop some minimum requirement, because there was a huge 2,000 crores worth of spurious biostimulants were used in the agriculture. So to discourage that, these guidelines have to be made. So you, if you say or if you do, you have to abide by certain guidelines. Now I will come to some bitter suggestions for the society. You know, I am not criticizing you, I am criticizing myself as well, because I am a part of you and you are a part of me. We are all of the same fraternity. Now, basically, I am against opening a number of societies. Now, we already have, unless it serves some purpose, Himalayan Phytopathological Society of Plant Pathology may be important. But then it should not be, you may have to introspect yourself how judicious or important purpose you are serving. Are you simply, you want to create one because Delhi has one, Punjab has one, Udaipur has one, Maharashtra has one, Gujarat has one, and different states have one. And now it is very difficult, and every time I go to areas and places to get grant for these annual functions, I get a scolding. But somehow I try to work out, and for all these things, while as ADG, I could impress upon and bring some grants from them. But then this is going to be, unless we have a convergence, unless we serve different purposes, are you framing any policy? You have to introspect. As a Himalayan society, you have to introspect. Are you serving any purpose? Framing any policy which are advocated to Government of India, that Himalayan Society of Plant Pathology needs to be consulted before introduction of any kinds of food from outside. Recently, again while I was ADG, 74 lakh apple seedlings were introduced from Italy, you know, and these saplings were grown and released by the state even without waiting for the state University of Horticulture and Forestry to know the final result. And later on, when they were distributed, a committee was set up, and my friend Dr. Satish Gupta was there in that, to whom I had to question. But then it became a difficulty on my part, that having planted them all over the state, where will we go and how to find out? Some of them, they were harboring diseases. Some of them had stem beating. Some of them had leathery leaf, and some of them had some flat limb virus. So these were there. So as a Himalayan society, you should have certain say in introduction and policy making with regard to plant protection, with regard to movement of the plant within the state. And similarly, has the society taken a note and action here? Dr. Bipal Singh may have not been there at that time, but you know that potato cyst nematode or golden nematode, which used to be a quarantine nematode of South India and Nilgiri Hill, it is now present in all the 7 districts of Himachal Pradesh. And since it is a national institute, a national symposium, I don't hesitate to tell that it is there very much in the premises of CPRI Shimla. I am a ICR man. I am not criticizing anybody. But then we need to see that how it came to the state, where we failed. So this society should do and do something very usefully. Do you as a Himachal society have any say when government of India banned recently 27 widely used generic pesticides which are used in the state very commonly, very cheaply? These are very cheap pesticides. What did you do? As an IPS, as a president of Indian Phytopathology Society, I tried to forge a union among all the existing society, and we made a very big meeting with the TAS, NAS, and then a policy framework was sent to government of India to not to go ahead for banning these 26-7 generic pesticides, which India not only makes for the country, but also earns a lot of foreign exchange to them. How have you contributed your wisdom when government of India introduced pesticide management bill in parliament in 2020? This pesticide management bill, it is a very old bill, otherwise we are following Insecticide Act 1968, which is a very old, but did you have any intervention or as a society when the government of India had gone for last 2008 it started and till 2013, 2020, now it is standing in the parliament. It has already been cleared, but it is waiting the nod of Rajya Sabha. ICR had some objections to it. We have passed it on to the parliament, and let us see what happens. But as a stakeholder, you should engage. Society should engage in policies related to movement of disease plants and advocate the same to prevent their spread from one district to others. State government and central government. So you say state and central government should ask you as a society, as a center of the society, Himalayan society, University of Horticulture and University. You should map diseases and pests with respect to states that do not exist in the state to prevent their entry from other parts of the state. Should prepare a map for disease-free area for production of disease-free materials for export. Because many of the countries are demanding potatoes or many other things which are grown in the country. So unless you show that they have arisen from a disease-free area, PCM-free area, they cannot be exported. So you should strive forward to identify disease-free area for apple and other three commodities which you export to other part of the country and other part of the world. You should engage in dialogue with other national and regional societies of the country to devise ways for plant health management beyond 2020. These are the few thoughts which I jotted down, and I thought you all as a student and as a worthy member of the society, we should realize not only for the state but for the country. I am grateful to Honorable Vice Chancellor for providing this time and opportunity to me. To be with you all, and also whenever given an opportunity, I will be glad to do and to get myself engaged with the university or with the society to do anything which I can do. Thank you all. Thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your inspiring words and the roadmap you have shown to the society. We hope you will continue to guide us in the future too. Now, coming over to the last leg of this inaugural session, I invite Dr. Narendra Bharat to please come for the formal vote of thanks, please.
Thank you, ma'am. So, for vote of thanks, first of all, I would like to thank our chief guest of today's function, Dr. E.K. Chakravarti, member ESRB, New Delhi, for gracing today's function. Sir, in spite of your busy schedule, you joined us online, and we are very thankful to you, sir. So, I especially thank Dr. Ravindra Kaushal, Honorable Vice Chancellor of our University, for accepting our request to preside over the inaugural function, and sir, also for your continuous guidance and encouragement in organizing this symposium. I thank Dean College of Horticulture, Dr. Anju Dhiman, and Director Extension Education, Dr. Ravindra Sharma, and all other statutory officers of university for their guidance and organizing this event. I also thank all the farmers who are connected during this inaugural ceremony of National Symposium and will connect thereafter during farm-scientific interaction. I thank all the distinguished scientists who have done best in their respective fields for accepting our request to give the lead lectures on various topics of national importance in this symposium. Your lectures will be the most valuable thing to the proceedings of this symposium. I also thank all the participants, including scientists, researchers, students, who have contributed their research findings to give strength to the deliberations during these 2 days. I thank various firms for their financial support in organizing this symposium, especially Namdhari Seeds, UPL, Bayer, BASF, Dhanuka, International Scientific Surgicals, and many more. I take the opportunity to thank Professor and Head Department of Plant Pathology, Dr. H.R. Gautam, who is also the President of Himalayan Phytopathological Society and Chairman of Organizing Committee, who is the actual manager of this event, and under his leadership, we all were able to organize this function. I also thank the conveners of all the and member as well of various organizing committees, especially Dr. Sunita Chandir, Dr. Satish Sharma, Dr. Anil Handa, Dr. P.L. Sharma, Dr. Rajesh Kaushal, Dr. Sandeep Kansal, Dr. Dharmesh Gupta, Dr. Bhupesh Gupta, Dr. Meenu Gupta, Dr. Shalini Verma, Dr. Manika Tomar, Dr. Savita Jandai, Mr. Kailash, and Mr. Suchet Atri, PR of the University, and VC of his staff, and others for their timely help in organizing this event. I also thank the print and electronic media, and particularly the social media platforms like YouTube and Facebook, for the outreach of this program among all in different parts of the country. I once again thank everyone whose contribution has made this symposium a success. Jai Hind, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. With this is the end of the inaugural session. We shall be meeting after 15 minutes to start with the next session. Thank you all. Thank you.